So let's continue the discussion. So hope you have understood now. So when we have stride, so we can use this stride also. We need to use this stride also to compute the effective dimensions of the feature maps. So essentially, because stride is the shift that we do from in calculation of the convolutions, stride will come in the denominator. So that means if we have stride of 2, we'll be jumping like this. Okay, from here to like this. Okay, while doing convolutions. So here if we do convolution, okay, and then we again put the kernel again here, then in this side, we'll be jumping up to here and putting the kernel here and calculating the convolution here and here. Okay, effectively what you will be getting is, but here we can't put because the we don't have the borders here. Okay, so we will only effectively left with only these two. Fine. So you will have the dimensions of the output map being 2 cross 2. So that is effectively depicted by this formula, wherein you have actually M. So the stride is there in the denominator. Okay. And when we pad with zeros, with some like P rows on the top, and then P rows in the bottom, then it will be M plus 2P. Essentially need to be used for in place of M. Similarly, N plus 2P need to be used in place of N. If we pad with the P columns, okay, with zeros this side and P columns with zeros this side. Hope these are clear. This will help essentially calculating the dimensions of feature maps. Once we know the dimensions of feature maps, we can easily calculate the dimensions of the subsampling maps and so on. Hope these are clear. Any questions here?
Sir, general question about striding.
Right.
Why should we actually use more than stride one, sir? So wouldn't that actually lose information?
Yeah. So the answer for this is, see, how finely we want to have the feature information from the images. See, if you use stride one, it means that at every pixel we are putting, at every pixel in this current feature map or in the current image, we are putting a kernel and trying to extract the feature in the neighborhood. Okay, but the information, if it is not too dense, in the sense that if the object has not much, that much information, there is no need to put at each location and find out. And the kernel, when it is put, it is already taking care of these all pixels and segregating the information and putting here. So effectively, there is a good overlap, almost 50% overlap when I put again here. Is it not? So if I do with stride 2, what effectively I'm doing is I'm avoiding the subsampling layer to have an explicitly different layer. Okay, so directly I will get with the reduced dimension instead of say, if I perform a convolution layer with stride 1 versus stride 2, I will be getting the dimensions of the feature maps almost by half. Okay, while effectively getting the feature information in with all pixels taken into account. So you, if you use 3x3, all these pixels are already taken. So all these pixels are already taken care while extracting the features in the first pixel. Okay, first convolution. In the second convolution, you are taking care of these things. So the overlap in the stride one is more, in stride two is less. Okay, but essentially there is no pixel left without taking its feature information to the next level. While the feature map that we get, that I get as a result, is of reduced dimension. So anyway, not just the feature extraction is our goal in convolutional neural networks. We also need to do compact representation of the feature information. So in some sense, if I want to prefer to do with stride, it means that I decided to take the both steps together. That is feature extraction and compact representation of the information together. Okay. So if my dimensions of the input maps are very high, I want to reduce to small dimensions, then one way is unless we can do with strides. Okay. So that we can effectively be representing with smaller dimension feature maps and explicitly we may or may not have the pooling layers.
Yes, sir. So why don't we actually prefer this over pooling in general? Because this is computationally very less intensive compared to...
Correct. Right. So there is a compromise anyway. See, if we are doing only here and if we are not localizing the filter again here, it means that so we are not we are effectively not centering or not focusing the information around the in-between pixels. So there may be some important information at that pixels, which we may not be effectively be capturing. So in that case, we will not get it in the subsequent layer. But whereas if we do with stride one, see if there is a corner in between, okay, two strided pixels where I am performing convolution operation. Okay, so then what will happen? That corner is missed if I do directly strided convolution. Whereas if I perform usual convolution like with stride one, okay, and then if I perform pooling, then that corner will not be missed. Or the highlighting of feature, which is at the middle of two strided locations, or stride between stride two locations, is not missed.
Generally, sir, pooling is for that nonlinearity, right? And this is a linear
operation. No, pooling is not for nonlinearity. After convolution layer, one thing I forgot to mention is we apply the activation function after each convolution operation in the convolution layer.
Can we avoid that pooling actually with this?
See, in some cases it is yes. The answer is yes. As I said, the reason is if we are not too much, the information is not too much dense. See, if you have a target detection application, okay, where you have the target itself is very small. Okay, in that case, if you keep doing strided convolution, if you don't keep the convolution kernel at the exactly target location, okay, you will be lost. In that case, better not to do strided convolution, do full convolution, and then perform pooling, because in pooling, you are not losing information. You are picking the important information. You are losing some information, fine. But you are highlighting or giving more preference to picking the main information. Okay. While as in strided convolution, a priori itself, you are deciding that only these locations I will do feature extraction. Okay. Remaining locations. Okay. I assume that it is already roughly covered. Okay. They may not be highlighted, but they are covered. Okay. And then I will, this is a compromise. So if the information is roughly distributed in the image, I don't mind face recognition, for example. It's okay. So face will not be there at a single point. I don't mind. Okay, performing strided convolution as well. Okay, but however, if in still eyeballs are important and so on, still you may need to do full convolution.
But actually, okay. At least reducing the half after a few convolution, it will become like a 3x3.
Correct. It depends upon the dimension, right? Initial dimension of the feature map. The initial dimension is 512 cross 512 and 1024 cross 1024. Then it takes not many.
Miss, as you mentioned, right, there may be a lot of hundreds of convolution layers. So by that reaching actually the 100th or that one.
It can happen. 3x3, it may happen. See, it's essentially, what does it mean? It finally became 3x3 means the whole image that you have seen here. Okay, so that you are able to see this image, right? This whole image, if I perform, say, a series of convolution layers, okay, and sampling layers, and convolution layers, and sampling layers, if I perform all this, finally, if I have a 3x3 map here, okay, it means that looking roughly the whole image, okay, the receptive field, that's what we call, of this pixel is roughly the whole image itself. I hope you got the point.
Yes, sir.
And each pixel look at the whole image in a different way. Okay, it can happen. Okay, or if not, it takes roughly, it represents the majority of the image. So up to this portion, it may look at the first one. Okay, and then this portion, it may look at the second, the third one, and so on. Okay?
Oh, but the important is actually the weights through which is that one.
Yeah, so the kernels are what are preserved. So K1, K2, all those things. And then the subsampling is anyway a straightforward process. Because if we are doing pooling, we know that is the procedure. If we are doing downsampling, that is half 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. It is by 2. Okay, downsampling by 2. And then these kernels are preserved. So you know how exactly the learning has happened from this image to features. Okay. And that features to classification also, you know, how after converting these two, say, if it is 3x3, I convert this to, okay, 9x1, finally. And this 9x1 is connected to whatever 3-class classification or 2-class classification output layer. Okay, and then I know the weight matrix here is nothing but it will convert this say 3x9. So is the weight matrix, and then I know that this will move the output layer is equal to our net value of output is equal to W times into the hidden fully connected layer output. Okay, is this? So I this is the relation through which I get the output. So I know with what W are the weights I have connected to the output layer. I know through which kernels I have got the features. Okay. And hence I know the, I can reproduce the labels for the input images. Okay. After training is done. And the test image also will have the labels corresponding to correct classes.
Yes. Nice.
Okay. Are there any questions around?
Sir, how we decide on the number of kernels which we use? Is it a hyperparameter? Yeah. We experiment with it?
Yeah, usually it's a hyperparameter, but it depends upon the complexity of the problem. See, for example, if it is a 10-class classification and digit classification, even 5-layer network is good enough. Okay, if it is, image classification, even 10-class itself, but see, image classification. Okay, then you may need a little deeper network. If it is only 10 class, but it is a lot number of images to be or similar images to be classified. Okay, then even more deeper network. If it is 1000 class and then image classification, you may need much more deeper networks and so on. Deeper network means at each layer you have different kernels. So the number of effort to length of the convolution neural network is calculated based on the number of learnable layers. Okay, that means subsampling layer, we don't count as the additional layer. Okay, if there is a convolution layer and the fully connected layer where we are learning some weights or kernels, we consider them as the learnable layers and add to the length of the depth of the neural network or convolution universe.
Right. And anything in specific which enable us to decide the kernel size which we use for different applications?
Yeah, we will discuss on that. So in fact, there are the architectures, how they evolve, we will be discussing in the subsequent classes. So there you will get to know that the smaller dimension kernel maps are preferable. So there are some guidelines on which we can decide on the kernel dimension.
Right.
Yeah. Fine. Any other questions here? Okay, let's move on now to the Okay, so this is 3D to 2D convolutions. So here you can see that actually we are converting at the beginning layer, at the first layer, as I said, we may have a single image. Are they two-dimensional image? But subsequently, when I perform perform convolution operation with 6 kernels, I may get 6 feature maps. Okay, so if I have now got 6 feature maps, Okay, so this is C1 comma J as we mentioned before, J equal to 1 to 6. Okay. So now from 6 feature maps, in the next layer, what I want to get, this is after first convolution, it's done. Okay, so then what I want is I may decide to get as many number of feature maps in the subsequent layer. Okay, I also have done subsampling. Assume that subsampling gave, some 6 feature maps with reduced dimension. So convolution is done and then subsampling is also done. Okay, I'm just assuming that the output is here. Which is in terms of 6 feature maps. Now what I want to do is, from this 6 feature maps, I want to get 12 feature maps. Okay, subsequently, the question is, how do I get it? Okay, so the answer is, from these 6 feature maps, we need to perform 3D to 2D convolutions to get to each of the next layer feature maps. This is C2 layer, okay? So these 6 feature maps together will give me first map here. Okay, so how do they give? With kernel K2, which is operating from J, all J, okay, all J feature maps here, or two particular K feature map. Okay, So essentially, if I write the expression C2 of K is equal to, okay, K2, kernel 2, convolution with J, comma K, convolution with, so it is performing convolution with what? S1 I write, because I have already performed subsampling, S1 of J, and summation over J, J equal to 1 to 6. I hope this is clear to you. So what it is essentially doing is, second kernel with K index, okay, having actually J also as an index, okay, so that it performs the convolution with the corresponding jth feature map to get one feature map in the output layer, subsequent output layer. Essentially, if you understand now, K2, okay, is 5 cross, if this is say whatever dimension, say assume that we have 12 cross 12, okay, dimension and 6 feature maps here, okay, and we want to get actually subsequently some feature maps here, 12 feature maps I want to get here, okay, this is what I want. So now the dimension of, yeah, let us conclude just with this discussion in this class. So K2 is dimension 5 cross 5. Okay, K2 is of dimension 5 cross 5. Then how many such K2s are there? So K2 of 5 cross 5 cross 6. Okay, there are 6 K2s of 5 cross 5. And each of these 5 cross 6 with the gets convolution with, will be convolved with 6 feature maps to give rise to only one output map. Like that, I will be having 12 output maps to get the 12 output maps. There are 12 5 cross 6 kernels that I use, okay, to get them. Oh, is the discussion clear? Because time is less, I just conclude here, 5 cross 6. Okay, this is what is K dimension, and cross 12 to get me the output maps. From S, okay, S1, which is of, okay, 12 cross, six to C2, which is 8 cross 12. Okay, what I'm doing is, this is index for K, this is index for J. So to get a particular first, okay, one first, or one of the output convolution layer map, what I'm doing, I'm convolving with all six. Okay, J is six here. This is all six feature maps of 5 cross 5 with the corresponding sampling layer feature maps. Okay, here also J equal to 1 to 6. Okay, and then adding them to get the one convolution map. Like that, the things are going. So each convolution map is obtained by convolution of 6 feature maps with 6 kernels of 5 cross 5. And like that, 12 times I am doing to get the 12 output maps. Is this clear? I conclude here because the time is over. Oh, but is this clear?
Any quick question? You will get only 6 maps at the output.
What is that?
So in the second convolution layer, we have 5 cross 5 kernels, 6 kernels of 5 cross 5. Right. And in the previous, after a subsampling, we have got 12 cross 12 feature map, and there are 6 feature maps.
Right.
So if I convolve all 6 kernels with all 6 feature maps to get one right. value, at the output, I'll get only 6 feature maps.
No. See, I will sum them. That's what I'm doing. See, if you see even in this, what's happening? You are taking actually three kernels, 3 feature maps, doing convolution operation, summing them to get only one map. Like that, if you take 5 cross 5 as the dimension of kernel, 5 cross 5, okay, 6 such things, get convolution with 6 feature maps and sum them to get only one. Okay, like that, you do 12 times. You get 12 different ones. So each time the K, which is 5 cross 6, is being different. Okay, they're not same case. So 5 cross 6, one set will give me one map. Another set of 5 cross 6 will give me next map, and so on.
Right.
Yeah. So hope this is clear. We will discuss again if this is not clear in the next class. As I mentioned, there is a function also, convolution function, say activation function also here, which we have not included, okay, in the convolution operation, just for simplicity. Oh, so we will discuss further in the next class. Thank you.